Let's talk about Israel for a moment. Israel and seltzer bombs. I'm going to read a short excerpt from the book. I'm going to interrupt it with a little video and some audio. I heard all sorts of rumors when I was working on the book, and a lot of them were crazy, and I loved tracking them down to see what was true and not. And this is one of the craziest ones I think I had to track down. Is this ringing a bell for anybody? Someone going, yeah, I think I know something about that. I'm always curious to find out. Okay, so what I'm going to do is read a short excerpt from the book. Again, I'll explain some context of what it'll show, and what you will see. So I've talked about this in the podcast and on the blog, but I've never gave the answer. You guys are going to be the first ones to see the answer about what this is all about, and then I'll read some conclusion to it. And then we'll go back with some more stuff. So this chapter, this section is called, I don't say that yet. While researching this book, rumors flocked to me like children to an ice cream truck. I rigorously tracked down even the most unlikely of rumors. And to my surprise, not all were as half-baked as they first seemed. The great thing about rumors is that if they are held by more than one person, even if the content of the rumor is false, that in and of itself is evident that something happened, something they all experienced or heard, albeit false. And tracking down and locating the source of a false rumor can be just as rewarding as learning the truth. Take, for example, what I learned last Passover at my mother-in-law's. Frankly, I don't understand all these one-liners about meddlesome mother-in-laws. I love Gaby, my wife's mom. Like many Jewish women of her generation, she has a giant heart, a passion for life, and when the holidays come around, cooks up a storm. Her brisket, for example, with the fried onions on top, cannot be beat. And her roulade, thin sliced pieces of brisket rolled around pickles, sends me to heaven every time. It certainly doesn't hurt that she's 4'11" to my 5'5". In her house, I feel like a giant. Gaby was born in Jerusalem in 1945, 3 years before Israel declared its independence, and 6 before her parents immigrated to the United States. Her parents fled to Israel from the Holocaust, running from Austria and Germany. Her dad became a waiter in the King David Hotel. Her mom earned money cutting hair. Stories from that time pepper Gaby's Passover table, like the one about the carp in the bathtub, paid for with food rations, destined for gefilte fish until infant Gaby accidentally chased it down the stairs. This year, after the retelling of the fish tale, the subject of this book arose. And like many times the subject is raised, it was met first with skepticism, there's enough for a whole book, then creative engagement, actually, how about a chapter on egg creams, and then finally obsession. How about recipes and soda fountains? And did I mention egg creams? That night I heard something completely different, something I could never have imagined in my wildest dreams. Ira, Gaby's closest cousin, clearly in his creative engagement phrase said, you have to include the part about Israel dropping seltzer bombs in the War of Independence. Seltzer bottles as bombs in Israel? It sounded too absurd to be true, like a perfect internet rumor. Oh, absolutely, he insisted, absolutely. Gaby insisted, I already told you this last month. Yeah, you dismissed me as crazy. Oops, I probably had. If I wanted to vindicate myself with Gaby, now I had to track it down, as bizarre as it might be. They didn't do it to hurt anybody, Gaby added, as if assurance was necessary, as if they really weren't trying to kill anyone in the war for their very survival. It was just to scare the Arabs. Ira agreed. When they fell, they whistled, sounding like a missile, which made the Arabs scatter. Well, as bizarre as it sounded, at least they were in agreement. How they knew it to be true, neither could say. I couldn't wait to get home and start tracking it down. The next day, I turned for help to a listserv about American Jewish history. If you're not familiar with listservs, think of them as an online discussion based in email. I shared my tale from the previous night and asked if anybody could confirm the unusual allegations. Before Passover had come to a close, my first response appeared on the list. It's supposed to be true, Barry, a woman named Martha wrote. The soda bottles made a huge noise and hit in the ground and exploded. It scared the Arabs. I was told that we did this because we didn't have any ammunition, so we used the soda bottles instead. Evidence was nowhere in sight, but I had achieved triangulation, confirmation from a third source. I noticed the points in common, the use of seltzer not to hurt but to scare, the focus on the sound they made. It was now a definite rumor, not just a family story. After a little Googling, I found the only place I can imagine knowing more about the Israeli Air Force than the man who created it. I investigated him as well in his biography. The only place official enough whose word could not be denied, the Israeli Air Force itself. After visiting their official website,